you all so much for joining. This is TransNation Film Festival 2016. I'm joined here by the most illustrious panel you could ever possibly imagine. Birthday girl, Geena Rocero. Supermodel, advocate, activist of the world. Allie Hoffman, producer and co-creator of Gender Proud Productions. And the brilliant triple threat, Jen Richards, actor, writer, director. And supermodel. I wanted to just open today's panel with a question. I think that there's been such a focus on the way that trans people are disadvantaged in the industry, in Hollywood specifically. How do you think the rest of society is disadvantaged by not having trans people in the driver's seat? So like within the microcosm versus the bigger picture.
What a great question, Zackary. You know, I think part of what art enables in culture is for us to think metaphorically. And we're so focused on technical thinking, which allows us, you know, to problem solve and stay alive and get things done. But it's really metaphorical thinking that allows us to see greater possibilities, to move forward as a culture, to do change, and ultimately to really adapt and move along. And I think the fuller that any kind of art is, or any kind of media depictions, the more metaphorical possibilities are allowed. And so it's kind of in a wider culture's interest to have as much diversity as possible. And I think in this day and age, when we're at such a crisis point in so many ways, both physically, geopolitically, socially, psychologically, spiritually, to lift up the stories of people who quite literally embody change and the capacity for radical transformation, the kinds of people who begin from a given place and are told that they have certain limitations that they then go on to transcend in the face of tremendous obstacle. I think like we are the metaphor for what can save the world. And I really mean that. I tend to like shy away from the whole trans person as a trope and as a metaphor in service of a cis story. But when we get to actually tell our stories in their fullness with all of their nuance and complexity, I do think we become kind of metaphors for what's possible and for what's changed, and that really can transform other people.
I want to add, am I on?
Yes.
Thank you again for having me here. I'm so excited. I remember, just a little context, when I decided to share my story and come out as a trans woman, this was about a year and a half ago, I was invited to speak in India at a conference. And after the conference, a woman came up to me and said, "So Geena, all this story that you're talking about, so what's the advantage of being trans?" I was like, okay, I've never been asked that question before. And initially, I just wanted to be snappy and say, because we're fabulous and all that, just that. But it took me a while to just, okay, I just basically, despite all this, the pain, the feeling alone and feeling like, I can't be fully myself, with the work that I do, I felt like I have now this sense of compassion, to the world that's been led to believe that it just exists within this binary. So that sort of message and intentionality that I put into the sense of purpose about what I'm doing now, that I get to do this work with Ellie and everybody being so fulfilled and being so, bringing all of myself in the work that I do, allows me to do, it determines on some of the work that I'm doing, which is some of the stories that we wanna produce, some of the stories that we wanna tell. So it starts with that very personal acceptance, personal, my self-love that I've finally accepted myself, get rid of that shame. So it started with that. So if I could give that much of myself to the work that I'm doing, I think, I'm off to a good start.
Allie, why don't you tell me about how you got started, how you decided to become a producer? What were the moments that led up to the path that you're on now, and where you are today?
Sure, so Geena loves when I tell
the
very first moments of how we became partners in this incredible journey. We had a mutual group of friends, and Geena had heard about the work I was doing at the time I was raising money for documentary films. And she sent me this Facebook message. I was like, I'm about to do something extraordinary. I've heard about you through our friends. I would love to get on a call and talk about your hopes and your dreams. And I was like, someone wants to talk, have a business call about my hopes and my dreams?
That's the way to get the business.
Definitely taking that call. Like, that's amazing. And so from there, and actually at the time before Geena came out, she was thinking about doing a documentary. We issued plans to do that when we found out she was gonna come out at TED, and instead we decided to focus all of our energy on making the most of the moment that was created when you have a successful TED Talk. And that was really where Gender Proud was born. And you know, we're really candid about the fact that there was a period of iteration and like experimentation, like what's this thing gonna be? What do we want to do? What's the change that we want to see? And you know, we're thinking about like, could we be active in policy change, specifically globally, where you know, could we use media and a spotlight to create change on gender marker in countries like Brazil and France, where at the time, this was 2014, you know, people were still so much more limited. And so we went through a lot of different options, and where we ultimately landed was that our abilities and our resources were really in storytelling, and we believed in the power of storytelling to create empathy, to dismantle previously held perceptions or perhaps discriminations. And so that's really where we started. And then I can tell the story of like how our first project came into being. So we really wanted to do a participatory photo project with trans youth. And so we got with the LGBT Center in New York, and we sat down with a bunch of extraordinary youth, and we said to them, you know, what do you want to do a photo project about? And they said, well, we want to do something where we're as beautiful as we want to be. And we're like, that's what it's called. It's called Beautiful As I Want to Be. So we did this photo project with them. We loved doing it. And when we delved into their stories, we realized we really want to make episodic video content about this. And so we put it together, a pitch deck, and we were taking it to all of these different digital distributors. And we, at the time, Geena was like on an embargo, if you will, so we couldn't base it all around her. So we like we tried to get all these other amazing trans activists that we'd gotten to know involved as mentors. So we thought the structure should be mentor and youth. And so we put together that structure, and we were pitching it, and we weren't really getting any momentum at all. And then one day we got a call. First I had to sign an NDA. We got a call, I had to sign an NDA, and then on the other end of the line was a producer from Beauty Murray, and Caitlyn Jenner was about to come out and about to announce her show, and they wanted Geena involved, and they're like, but does Geena have anything she's doing with the trans community, specifically youth, that Caitlyn could do too? I was like, actually, we do. We have that thing. We have exactly that thing. We are going to do this, and we'd love for Caitlyn to be involved, and like, kind of against all odds, they're like, okay, like, Eastside, you know, there's like layers of, permissions you have to get to have like somebody like that involved in your media project versus like your media project and their media project. But we got all the approvals like kind of by some miracle, and then you know, it was all very like down to the wire, because you know, there was like a one window that she was available that we could do this. And you know, we were like very, very green, right? We never like all of a sudden we have Caitlyn Jenner willing to be in a TV show that was like, you know, it was like, it was still a PDF file. Like, we had not like ever brought anything to life like this before. So, you know, we just sort of did what we knew how to do, which was get all the smart people we knew involved and, you know, get it pulled together. And then ultimately Logo bought it, and it became, and we'll show some clips at some point from the stuff that we've made, but you'll see it became a series called Beautiful As I Want to Be.
You know, I think that entertainment does have the power to influence policy eventually, right? Because it reaches so many people, and people take that into the voting booth, and whether they know LGBT folks or not, or, you know, through entertainment, they're familiarized with our stories, and that leads to social change in a more kind of like direct and irrefutable way. But that brings me to the thing that I was thinking when all of you were talking, something I think about often as an artist, as a cultural producer, as somebody who's kind of navigated different platforms. I think that your audience is always shifting, 2014, very different cultural circumstances than 2016. We've made like this incredible leap thanks to, everyone on the stage as well as all of our comrades out there who are putting themselves out there, whether it's by making films or web series or YouTube videos or just being present and being visible on social media. How do you, I have my own answer to this, but I wanna start with you, Jen, and go down. How do you visualize your audience? Who do you think your audience is? Who is your intended audience? And then what tactics do you employ to make sure the media you're making is seen by your targeted audience?
I wish I could say I was that strategic. I'm not. I do what I want. For me, for the type of art that I like to do, the type of content that I like to create, I'm so intensely in dialogue with so many people all the time that whatever I create is an immediate reflection of a whole network of relationships that are very dynamic. And so as rhetoric, as social norms are constantly changing, as long as I'm in dialogue with people, that then informs the writing. So, the one exception kind of is her story, because with that, the only audience I really cared about was other trans women. Like, ultimately, like, that's all I cared about. And when we've toured it all over the country, and we can have 100 people in the audience, and all I'm looking for is the trans women watching their reactions, because it was such a labor of love. Like, I just wanted us to feel seen by each other. It just so happens that by doing that really mindfully and really, with such attention to detail, ended up becoming inadvertently universal, and we have a very wide audience who can identify with it, and that's been wonderful. But yeah, for the most part, social media is really important to me. That's how I see things are constantly changing. I've seen words come in and out of fashion since I've been out. I liked watching how the whole, like, it was, went from transgender to trans with an asterisk, so that was bad, that it was good, and like, depending on who was saying it, what was the context. And it's not that there's no right or wrong, it's just that certain things mean certain things for certain people in certain contexts, and so if you're working in that context, you have to speak their language, and in a different context, you have to, we're all like kind of multilingual, in as much as we're creators and producers.
I would add specifically in one of the web series that we did called Willing and Able with Fusion. This was early spring. And I think specifically, initially we wanted to tackle the question about discrimination and unemployment rates for trans people, right? And we sort of like, that was the first idea. It's like, okay, what are we going to tell? Like, what story we want to tell? And certainly as a person of color, there was that much importance to make sure that we center that the narrative and the people talking about that. So this is in early spring this year. So at the time, initially we thought that the National Center for Transgender Equality, the new survey was coming out around June. So we thought maybe we could do this project where we tackle about, it's called Willing and Able, it's a web series, it's available in Fusion, where we really put the story of trans person of color about their experiences in the job market or not having a job, or what has happened when you're actually an entrepreneur. So, but specifically from a trans woman, person of color point of view. And I think at the time, because what we initially thought that the new survey was coming out, it was a perfect timing, that once it comes out, let's launch it. But talking about this constant, fluidity about strategy and not knowing really, there's not an absolute that it's gonna be launched at this certain time. It turns out that the survey was not coming out, but we were like, what else we could do? So on their launch date that we did, we actually partnered with the New York Office of the Mayor, and we did a panel at the City Hall. The First Lady of New York was there. So it was just an incredible sort of, right at the moment type of thing where we were thinking, this one avenue of strategy, and we did an event at the Office of the Mayor, and she was there. They talked about the specific policy that they have in New York City supporting trans anti-discrimination. So, you never know. Sometimes, we want to do a certain way. Yes, it would have been such a big thing because certainly the media component around the new survey that's been, mostly quoted for so many years, right? The discrimination at every turn. I think that was the first, that was like the biggest, study, and we realized it's not going to work. So we have to find other avenues, and that worked out really well.
And just to add your note about audience, so, you know, as a media company, we do two things. We see ourselves as managing and maintaining a community that we interact with every day on Facebook. So our Facebook has, like, I think 30,000 people that are daily getting, you know, information, tidbits, conversations from us. And that's actually managed and maintained by this, like, amazing 22-year-old named Nat, who's at school in Swarthmore, who's actually in the process of transitioning right now. And we just gave Nat free rein, and he's been doing incredible things. And so there, though, we have a lot of data about who we're talking to, how we're talking to them, what works, what doesn't, like, what people want from us, like, where, how they feel most seen, what the ways they feel most seen. And so that's been really valuable because we do have a huge volume of data. When we produce media, you know, we sit down at the beginning and we really think about, like, who are we trying to reach with this? You know, is this a piece that we want for the community? Like, is this something that we want to do because we really believe in it and, like, we want to tell the story, a story that needs to be told? Is this something where we want to bring the conversation to the mainstream? Like, that's something we're thinking about every time we start a new project. And the answer is no, you know, and that does shape, like, what we do and how we do it. And, you know, it's been, you know, Geena's always been so good about being the anchor and making sure whatever we do, you know, is for the community, by the community, with the community. Like, we don't work on any project where we don't have, like, as much of an all-trans, like, cast, crew, makeup, hair, because it gives the content, hopefully, you guys can judge for yourselves, but an authenticity and a realness and a gift that it wouldn't otherwise have.
I just want to add one other thing. You can see the difference between social media and web series and television and movies and their capacity for being responsive to the changing norms of discourse and culture. So with social media, you can like literally see a conversation change over the course of a couple of hours, like something's okay and then 2 hours later it's not. With television, they're a lot more responsive. You'll see a show that's a kind of story of the week and it was like a hot topic 3 or 4 months ago. With movies, you know, so I worked on The Danish Girl, and kind of after it had been shot, you know, consulting with the director and with Eddie, and what we really saw there was in the time from that, you know, it had been like a 20-year process, basically, not quite that long, but it had been taken so long from story to actually being out in the world that the world had completely changed, and the things that were okay when they started were no longer okay when it came out, and that's a real problem with the pace at which movies move.
So I'm going to throw out my 2 cents just for fun. You know, in the history of art, there's this incredible performance artist named Lorraine O'Grady, who was a woman of color who kind of would employ these like guerrilla tactics and going into really kind of affluent spaces as like a beauty queen with a sash that said like Mademoiselle, what was it? Black bourgeoisie. And she is one of my favorite artists, but she talks about the enabling audience versus the consuming audience. And it's something I bring up all the time because it's so succinct. Your enabling audience being the people around you who get it, who are speaking the same language, who have similar references, who you want to inspire, that trans woman in the audience, you know, no matter where you are, just sort of looking and realizing that's my enabling audience, that's the person that I really want to speak to. And I am finding that with this wave of streaming content, there's a few different strains in here I'm gonna try to follow, but outside of the enabling audience is the consuming audience. And those are people who may not necessarily get all of it, but there's something so specific about what you're doing that it has a universal appeal. And I see this moment that we're in right now as the more specific we are, the more universal it is. And for so long, content was diluted to pander and cater to this sort of illusory mainstream, right? And it was like, let's make it as like white and homogenous and heteronormative and cisnormative as possible. So, you know, the maximum amount of people can identify with it. And I think thankfully we're kind of moving out of that, even on network television. And then within streaming content, I was thinking about these sort of secret statistics they have about who's watching, and the fact that that information is, you know, highly classified as far as I know, right? Because they are competing with these networks that have huge viewerships. Yeah, I don't know. It's interesting, like this sort of direction that we're heading in of almost like niche marketing, you know, of like finding specific communities and creating enough content to speak to all of these diverse kind of, and then you have people who just, you know, devour content and respond to things, whether or not.
The latest trend in marketing is identifying what are called micro-influencers, and using them to kind of brand things. So you find a bunch of people who have a small but loyal fan base that they can influence, you know, versus like kind of large marketers with a mass message.
I think there's also a component of timing around that. You know, we've been so lucky to have had a partnership with Fusion and Univision. I think the most recent TV documentary that we did, 20-minute documentary about, you know, this notion of tackling this this myth of competitive advantage about trans women competing for women at the Olympics, right? We started there, and then, you know, having a partnership with Univision in timing with the Olympics that was happening at the time. So there's so many forces that comes into play, and also at the same time, always be ready to adjust as it's happening, you know, because, you know, this is all happening so quick. When we were filming this and going, you know, from New York and traveling to LA to interview Caitlin, and we have other people that we profile that lives in California, and at the same time, we got to make sure we launch this during the Olympics. So there's a lot of forces around that, and having the support of Univision, which is predominantly, you know, Latin American culture, especially when we even launched Willing and Able, our second web series with Fusion. They have, at the time, they recently actually purchased The Root, which is predominantly African American audience. And, you know, two of the people that we featured in our, two of the trans women that we featured at Willing and Able are trans person of color. So there was that fit that made sense for us.
And I would say that's actually a project where who we were trying to speak to and trying to reach shifted. So that project originated because we were watching what was happening across the country when young high school aged kids were trying to compete on the team of their choice. And we were finding that, you know, whether it was the school board, whether it was city council, whether it was state assembly members, whether it was faith leaders, whether it was parents, like there were a lot of forces conspiring to tell these kids where they should go and what they should do and who they should be. And we wanted to explore that. And we wanted to explore it through the perspective and the lens of the young people that were affected, and kind of saw them as, you know, people were really playing out their agendas on these young people's bodies. And so we wanted to explore that, and that was really for the community, like that was gonna be one where we were gonna speak to the community. But then when the project went into development, and once it got into the hands of certain producers at Univision, it shifted dramatically, and it turned into exploring competitive advantage, and then it turned into a piece where we would explore, you know, what it means to compete at the high school, collegiate, professional, and Olympian level. And then it really, and you'll see, like it became like, you know, basically a piece meant to inform and deconstruct competitive advantage. And, you know, whether there was something that got lost, I don't know, whether it's something that got gained, I don't know, I don't have an opinion, but it is a really good example of when your audience, your target audience shifts, and sort of your why shifts.
So how do you see your role as media makers changing going forward? It's a trick question.
Yeah, I kind of have like two loyalties to the story, whatever it is. Like that's my kind of first and foremost fidelity. That trumps almost everything else. A story comes to me and it's kind of a gift, you know. It's anyone who's ever created a thing will, you know, understand that it doesn't really seem to come from you. And so I just try to honor that wherever it takes me, even if it makes me really uncomfortable. The only thing that kind of beats that is the actual lives of my community, which in my case tends to focus on trans women of color, you know, like Black and Latina, poor trans women in the United States, because it's just that issue has consumed so many of us for so long, and it seems so intractable, and it hasn't been improving. So it's kind of a meeting of those two things. So for instance, I think everything that I've done for the last few years has like, you know, centered or included, you know, trans women of color of strength and having agency and like giving like different, you know, models of possibility and hope and love and all these things. And that's where I'm honoring the story, but also kind of part of my focus and intention from behind that is also to elevate people who are typically most marginalized.
Yeah, I mean, I think speaking candidly as a white, straight, cisgender female, like, I see myself as, like, a vessel, like, in service, of service, like, meaning all of our conversations go, what do you want to make media about? Like, what stories do you want to tell? You know, and from there we take off, and I think, you know, we're lucky that there's, like, a contrast in skills and abilities between the two of us, and, like, you know, I could get, hopefully, like, make a meaningful contribution in terms of the media I hope, like, we continue to make. You know, I think, like, we're, like, a healthy dose of ambitious, but also, you know, highly, like, conscious of the fact that, you know, we stand on the shoulders of giants, and we want to continue to honor that. And so, you know, I hope that going forward we get to make media that's seen by a lot of people, and that it's great media, and that it's recognized as being great media. But beyond that, I don't, like, have, you know, a set agenda or, you know, a clear strategy.
Yeah, I think it's an ongoing thing. I mean, like, I'm interested in doing VR, you know, when are we going to do VR? And then, you know, just like what Ali mentioned, like, it's a partnership, and I would mention that to her, no, there is a different components in how you tell a story. So we are in constant conversation about, like, what platform, what medium we want to create, but certainly always asking, you know, that very specific story. Like, I could specifically name, like, that beautiful As I Want to Be web series with Logan. I mean, there's a lot of that component that was very personal for me, because as a model, you know, in New York City, and feeling like, you know, you're in a photo shoot and you're owning that, there's that, it has to be so personal, because, you know, the journey in producing and doing the marketing and launching and all that stuff, and the constant, you know, criticism or conversation with the community, it's gonna be a lot, and it's gonna be quite a journey. So you have to be really passionate in the subject matter that you're tackling in order to get to the end, and what happens after that, you know? So all of this stuff that we've done is really, really personal, and it's an ongoing thing. And, you know, as I said, I'm interested with VR. I know I've been talking about to Ali about this, and that, you know, because there's so many other mediums now to tell story and to, you know, to find the right partner, distribution partner that would support you in those engagements. So, yeah.
All right, Jen, you've been a very vocal proponent in casting and the effects of misrepresentation and having cisgender men play trans women.
Yeah.
Once we get over that hump, what do you see ahead of that?
Well, I'm really excited about what I'm sure is about to happen, which is not just trans people getting cast in trans roles, but trans people getting cast in any roles. That's a lot of what I've been doing over the last year, is meeting with casting directors and just convincing them of that. And I can always see it click in their head, like, oh. And, like, it never occurred to them to put a trans woman in, you know, like the barista, the cop, the doctor, the lawyer. And with Laverne Cox being on a new legal drama on CBS called Doubt, beginning in January, it'll be the first time that a trans woman's part of the main cast of a primetime show. And I think that's gonna open up a lot of casters to, oh, we can do that, it's possible, it's okay. You know, trans parents have been doing it as well. So I'm excited to see that. I'm personally really excited. I actually have another TV show that I wrote, a really messed up, complicated noir, southern noir kind of thing. But the main character is a trans woman, and it's an anti-hero. And I'm really excited to, you know, I've said before, although I think I'm quoting someone else, that we're still in the Sidney Poitier phase of trans representation, where everyone has to be completely, like, unimpugnable. You can't say anything wrong. You have to be liked by everyone.
Respectability politics.
Yeah, respectability politics, basically. And I'm really looking forward to getting past that, where we can have, because, you know, we know our community. We're a mass. And we have, like, the respectable ones are in the minority. Or we're just faking it. Because I sometimes forget I'm seen as one of them, but I'm not.
Every human, I think, deserves the right to be messy and weird.
Exactly. So I'm excited to, like, get past that and get to that point. And also get to the point where, like, I was in an interview the other day where they were asking about this, and I was saying, I have to keep repeating it. This isn't like an ethical, it's not like an ethical rule for me to say cis people can't play trans roles. Like, I'm an artist, I don't have rules like that. I think people can write and act and do anything. All I'm talking about is right now there are consequences when cis men play trans women. And I just think we need to be mindful of those consequences and we have moral responsibility. That's all it's about. Eventually, I would love for everyone to play everyone. Because I think it gets some really interesting things happen when we get to that point.
I think that's the nuance that's so important, what you said. Like, I just wanted to make that point, right? That, you know, there's consequences when those things happen. I think, you know, I would love to see when, you know, the stuff that we talk about in private, the stuff that we talk about, you know, when we're all hanging out, and yet we get to talk about that in public, while at the same time offering that nuance, offering that it's a conversation that we're owning, not from a cis gaze, you know, not from a producer who just wants to sensationalize that. So I think, you know, all the crazy mess conversations that we all have, you know, I hope someday we get to really, really talk about that. And it's going there, right? I mean, like, there was just this video that was posted in the Huffington Post about this trans lesbian with her lesbian cisgender friend, and they're in bed, and she's showing her about, you know, her vagina and her surgery, and they're talking about from a really funny point of view, and they're having fun doing that, you know. But that's sort of the thing that for the longest time, right, we really didn't want to talk about that, but maybe we need to talk about that because it's part of us, it's part of our conversation. That's the kind of conversation that I have with my friends, you know, but certainly the sensitivity. But there's a sensitivity component that needed to happen from 2 years ago to where it is now, that type of, you know, YouTube content is happening, that's out there, that's been talked about by two, you know, comfortable, happy women. It's just talking about their pleasure and their vagina and their own set of rules and the type of things that they want to talk about. So, you know, when we get to talk about this private stuff and in privacy, the stuff that we talk about, you know, when we're hanging out with friends and we get to talk about it in public, I think that's when it's good. As long as we own it, right?
Yeah, you know, I think that because of the long history of malignment, of misrepresentation of trans people in film and television, and the kind of moment of reset that we hit a few years ago offers a tremendous amount of constraint when it comes to shepherding the politics of representation and thinking very carefully about what will be helpful to our community, what things need to have a moratorium for a little while. And how we can move forward in a strategic and proactive way. I think we should watch a few clips. I feel like there was something else I was going to say, but I just totally...
This clip has our most three recent series all in one, so you're going to get a
little snippet.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that, you know, anyways, I wanted to establish kind of like the structure of our context right now, and kind of like the things that we're considering, the things that are operating kind of like in this culture.
I'll just piggyback on that and point out that those things will also change depending on who's telling the story. Mm-hmm. I know one thing that personally, it's a minor thing, but something that annoyed me is when another trans woman critiqued her story for focusing on sex work and addiction. Like, oh, that's such a cliche. And like, I understand that perspective, and I would say the same thing if it were another show doing it. But the fact that it was written, directed, and performed by trans people, and the fact that sex work and addiction are real issues within the trans community, the difference is who's telling that story. We're not doing it to other trans people, we're doing it to make them like whole subjects with complete agency. So a lot of the things that we might not want to talk about because of respectability politics will also shift depending on who's telling the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So should we watch some clips? So now I want to actually focus on like the nitty gritty and logistics of how do you get this content out there? Like, what are the steps that you guys have taken to pitching, establishing a network, finding your way to those kinds of meetings? And for Jen, I want to hear about what motivated your decision to self-distribute. And yeah,
now for us, it was a lot of definitely hustle. I mean, we went to so many, before we got to Logo, I won't mention the name, but there's definitely other distributing partner that wanted to do it for a very small amount of money. And we were like, we literally had to be in a call, it's like, okay, what feels right here? What feels, this something that we really believe in, we can't really go low in this one, we really believe in this, and thank God we stuck with, you know, not, you know, short selling about, I'm talking about Beautiful As I Want to Be. And then we ended up with Logo, and also the networking component was so critical. I met John Mallow, which at the time, he recently just
started working for a logo and their digital sort of division, and I met John at the White House when he spoke at the White House, and he said, I remember you, you spoke at the White House, and then we pitched him about some stuff that we're working on. And so that's really how sort of, you know, you'll never know who's in the room, right?
I have to say though about Geena, she's one of the most consummate networkers I've ever met. It's extraordinary. I remember before she was out, she hit up a bunch of us who were kind of visible in the trans community all at once and like very aggressively, but like with, you know, like with Ali, you know, stuff about dreams and hopes and love and beauty and all this kind of stuff.
I'm hitting it hard.
And I just remember like Angelica and I and Jana all being like, who's this Geena bitch? Like she's all up in our business. Like she gets all up at once, but it worked. And like all of a sudden, like you were at an event with all of us. Like she worked it, she got in. So she does that with everyone, everywhere.
Yeah, and I think like for us, it has been like years of grassroots network building. Sorry, I can't talk. It's just been, you know, one sort of leg up to the next. Like there's no, it's art, not science. You know, it's everyone we meet, it's every room we get to be in. But then like the journey from, you know, like knowing a John Mallow to selling a TV show was also really long. You know, we had to figure out really quickly like who the production, I mean, we were really green. Like I know I've said it before, but you know, we're like, what's a gaffer? You know? and we really, you know, I think there's definitely been an element of like learning the hard way and figuring it out. And now we're at a point now where we're like roughly 3 years in, and you know, now we know what to look for when we talk to production companies, and we know what to look for when we look at budgets, and we know, you know, what lawyers we want to work with and what accountants we need to work with, and we've got that down. But you know, it really was about being really tenacious. And then there was a lot of like really believing in Geena, I think has taught me this, is like sometimes I'll just be like, okay, well, they're just not interested. And she'll be like, no, email again.
Try it again. Today. I have to send that email right now because of the timing. It's really, yeah, it's a lot of hustle.
Persistence.
Like no means no right now. Maybe it changes. Maybe it's just a different deadline that they're working on. Like it's just so being persistent about, let's try it again.
And believing in it. Like that's something I think she's taught me too is, you know, like we would like, just to give an example of like her thinking and how it's like, you know, really constructive, I think in a lot of ways when you're in this industry, like we'll get invited to like an event and Geena will be like, yeah, we'll come, I'd like to present. You know, and like I'm just really pumped we're invited. Like, no, ask if I can present. Can I present? Am I walking the red carpet? You know, and it's not like demanding, it's not like, you know, her being a queen, it's like, no, this is a space I deserve to be in. This is a role I deserve to have. This is like, I want this. This is like, I should have this. And it's like that, you have to kind of be like that. You have to really believe in what you've got.
You don't have to because I'm not, but it works.
Yeah. I mean, the thinking a little bit behind it is like putting value on the space that I inhabit. Let's say there's a big event at the UN and like, component of the UN, like what does it mean? Certainly, you know, I always think like what value I could add in situations, like I don't want to just be someone who's invited and just take a photo and like all that stuff. So, like they really need to hear what I have to say. So sometimes it's a little too aggressive, but you know, that's just, I felt like that conversation or my point of view and that they needed to hear in that audience that we're at. But it's, you know, it's nice to, you know, have fun in a party, but like it's nice to put, when you know that you made an impact with someone in that room where, you know, maybe that person knows somebody at this television network, maybe that, you just never know. So I really try to think that I'm putting value in the spaces that we inhabit.
And I think the tenacity, I think that when you're coming from a marginalized history, you have a tendency to undervalue and to overcompensate, even if, when you are overcompensating, that's like other people's level of normal. You know, I am constantly astounded at, you know, working on big teams and big productions, the people who are the most persistent get really far. And then the folks who are, you know, more shy or don't kind of know when to ask, what to ask for, have a harder time kind of like establishing space. And I think that if we encourage that value in each other and in the next generation, it's just gonna continue to kind of like move us ahead and to move forward. I wanna press you guys though even more on like what is networking? You know, like how do you even figure out where you want, what room you want to put yourself in? Because that's such another, another big part of this, like being in the right place, you know, getting yourself there, finding it, you know, figuring out like, okay,
these are the people I want to kind of connect with and be in a community with. And then also, what does a presentation look like once you get your foot in the door?
We want to talk about willing and able, meaning what's your name, children?
Yeah, so, you know, I think for us, we are pretty strategic. Like every, you know, year I put together a budget that's like, what events are we going to go to? What are we going to spend money on in terms of like, are we going to go to South By? Or if we are, like, how are we going to be there? Like, we think these things through, right? We're pretty strategic about them. So I was at an event called Future of Storytelling, which is one we budget for every year. For year one we were invited, and then this year, like, we budgeted for it, but then I, like, talked my way in as a facilitator. That's the other thing, like, be scrappy. So I was like, I'll be a volunteer, but like, okay, you can come for free. That's another thing we do a lot. And so, though the first year we were there, and afterward we were talking, I was just having a casual conversation with somebody I knew peripherally through another network that we're part of, and, you know, talking to her about, like, what kind of content we wanted to make, actually pitched the high school, with what was happening with these high school kids. I think it was when Deerfield, Illinois was erupting. I don't know how many people followed the case of, I think they called them Student A, but we were really captivated by what was happening in Chicago, in the suburbs. And so I pitched that to her, then I also pitched what became Willing and Able, and then also what became the trans athletes piece you saw. And, you know, a week later she messaged me and she's like, I can't stop thinking about what you were talking about, let's do it. It turns out she was the chief of staff at Univision, they had extra budget, they put them into production. So it's, you know, obviously like a really wonderful story about when you go and, you know, you're just in the right place at the right time with the right person, with the right pitch. You know, and that hasn't always been the case. Like our relationship with Logo, being really candid, like, you know, we have to constantly go back and be like, hi, what about this iteration of it? What about this iteration?
So many ideas was like, and they're like, no, no, yeah. Or maybe that. It's just, we definitely have had so many no's in so many of our approaches, whether it's like the New York Times or, I won't mention all the other things, but certainly we've had a lot of no's, you know, but you know, turn it around, but like, we have to be persistent in asking these things.
Yeah, and just staying true to like the kind of media we want to make, and you know that we deserve a space, and that we want to continue to occupy a space, and this is what we want to continue to do. I think like that's always a conversation we have too. Like, what is this really what we want to be doing? You know, and the answer is inevitably always yes, and so we keep forward, and then we constantly come back together and be like, okay, what do we need to be doing to make this happen? You know, and then between our sort of dual forces, we get there.
I think there's sort of an undervalued concept of collecting rejection papers, you know, rejection letters, just as like evidence of the work that you're doing and the fact that you're putting yourself out there. And if you get 99 no's for every yes, it takes that 100 tries. And then eventually I think you make it to a point where like your ratio changes. What was that like for you, Jen? Your path to distribution on her story is so different, and it was really DIY.
Yeah, I did kind of do everything a little bit differently, and sometimes I get lucky. I'm actually not much of a network. I'm kind of reclusive. I'm, you know, in my head a lot, but what social media has allowed is been a place where I can share my thoughts. And so I've always, you know, kept blogs and written articles and like post my thoughts on Twitter and stuff like that. And so the content itself has earned its own audience. And then so everything that I've done since, it's been because people have asked me to do it. Like I'm brought in and they want to say, what else do you have? What are you interested in right now? Could you do this with us? Can you give us your perspective on this? So I haven't had to go out and search for things. Stuff has come to me, which has been great. But I do want to back up a little bit too, because I do recognize that like two advantages coming into her story were that prior to transition, you know, I had a long, full life, you know, as a, you know, straight white dude. So that gave me like a lot of kind of like strength and reserve and resources to like to be able to express myself and to say things in a way that I knew that it would be heard. And I ran, a $1 million nonprofit for many years, so I had experience in managing things, doing fundraising, doing accounting work, you know, running boards. So I had a lot of experience of doing those things, and the transition kind of like knocked me down. But those skills didn't go away. And then also, you know, for the 3 years prior to her story, I had been doing projects for the trans community that involved the trans community. So my first name was a website that collected positive experiences from trans people. So I collaborated with literally hundreds of trans people all around the globe. And then did the Trans 100, which again, you know, collaborated with like hundreds and hundreds of trans people around the world as volunteers and profile. So by the time her story came around, like everyone in the community, I'd already earned everyone's kind of respect. I never asked for anything. I'd only been elevating other people's stories for years. And so people were excited to like turn around and like support me. And they knew that I understood their perspective. I basically listened for 4 years before I really spoke. And I think that made a big difference and had all these relationships.
And just to add, you know, as Jenna was speaking, I was thinking about all the work she did as a writer and activist, and then Geena and all her speaking, like, you know, there's something to be said for if you want to make media, just start making, put it out there, don't wait, you know, and, you know, even for us, like, we've been in a lull between pieces, and, you know, we're about to head into production on something, and so we just, like, pushed out, like, a piece about gender nonconformity, like, and it went to Upworthy, and it was, you know, 2 minutes, but it was just, like, our effort to be, like, in the, you know, the Facebook page, we're always producing short-form content, we're just always, you know, trying to keep making stuff, keep doing, because I think that, you know, eventually stuff does hit, right? Someone sees something and says, like, hey, that's great, do you want to come here to do this? Or, hey, I love what you did with that, like, we have this, and I think it could be a good fit. Like, a lot of this industry is just timing, right? You know, it is so much circumstantial, and so I think that, you know, just make.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think back to you know, like when Laverne, Janet, Angelica, and I, like even before Gina's out, like there was a whole group of us who were kind of visible within the trans community, and we were all just making shit, the same thing, and like there wasn't an audience for it yet. This moment hadn't happened, that issue hadn't gone mainstream. It was before Orange is the New Black, before Caitlyn, before all this, but we were just doing it because it was the right thing. I mean, Zackary, like, what was it called? We did the talk show in Chicago.
The Skew.
The Skew.
This is the Skew. You guys don't know it, but this is another version of the Skew happening right now.
That's true. But we were just doing it because it was what we wanted to do, and because there was a need to do it, because there was a moral urgency with all the crises that would happen. And then all of a sudden, culture said, like, hey, we need trans people. And, like, we were there. You know, it's kind of that, like, we put in our 10,000 hours, so to speak, and we were ready to go.
Yeah, I mean, I think the preparation has a lot to do with it, and I certainly feel, you know, personally really fortunate that that moment didn't come too soon, you know, and that I had, like, 10 years of being a professionalized person in the world and, you know, navigating a trans experience was just one part of that. I certainly, like, you know, have a lot of concerns about the young people coming up who are in the spotlight in this moment, but I think that...
One other little thing, because you'd asked about the distribution for her story, and the reason we put it on YouTube was because we wanted, because again, it was really mostly made for trans people, and we wanted them to have access to it, so we didn't want it to be behind a paywall. And I know a lot of girls, you know, who, you know, can't afford Netflix or Amazon, don't even own a computer, but they'll watch YouTube videos on their phones or, you know, in libraries and stuff like that. And that's the audience we wanted to make sure had access to it. And at the time, it, you know, the thought of an Emmy nomination wasn't even, like, we weren't even, YouTube shows weren't even eligible. So, like, it wasn't something that had ever occurred to us that, like, a bunch of people with no celebrities, no marketing, no studio could just throw something up on YouTube and it get nominated for an Emmy. Like, that was just, no one could have guessed that.
Yeah. You know, I think that not getting stuck and continuing to, I know it's a writing process, just writing into, like, no matter what it is, whatever's coming to your mind, and not stopping, because that moment that you stop and start overthinking is kind of when your momentum is just stalled. And I think sometimes there's a lot of frustration in our community and resentment towards those of us who are producing things, because there is such a tremendous feeling of being stuck, you know, and I think that's probably something we've all navigated in our personal lives in different points. What other pieces do you have? We're getting towards the tail end, but what other pieces of advice would you have for young people who are interested in directing, producing, writing?
Do it. Start right now. Someone wrote me the other day, they were asking about, and they were kind of like, it was a whole thing about writing, like, oh, I've thought about writing my story, but I'm not sure, and I wrote them back, I'm like, you want to be a writer, go start writing right now. And I mean, like, literally, don't reply to this email, don't say thank you, close this email, go into Google Docs and just start writing. I don't care what it is, like, go be a writer. Like, that's just how you have to. I've been writing nonstop for 30 years now. You know, it's just something I have to do every day, no matter what. And then sometimes something gets made, but that's almost secondary to, like, it's for me to stay alive. I have to, like, constantly do it. So whatever it is, just do it. And like, I met a filmmaker recently on a panel, and she just made her sixth film, but she had come out as lesbian and started filmmaking at 50 years old. So there's never also like a too late to do it either. Like, she at 50, she's like, I think I want to make movies. Like, now I'm gay and I have something to say, so I'm gonna start making movies. And she's done six films already. You know, and she's having a blast doing it. So it's just do it.
Yeah, fear could really be a paralyzing component, you know, and it's obviously sometimes it's easier to say, like, acknowledge it and work around it, you know. And so I think the persistence of just getting yourself in the door, like, for example, I just got back from Sydney, Australia, and I was invited to speak at a forum there, but at the same time I had this other thing that I'm working on, and I actually reached out to anthropologists and linguists at the University of Sydney because I'm at the beginning research of something that I'm doing. And here I am randomly from the United States emailing all these professors and linguists and anthropologists about this thing that I'm doing. And I was there, got invited to speak in one of their class, and randomly this one person connected me to this other person. It's like this being, it's just this persistence of believing in the thing that you really want to do, and know that, you know, you need that drive to continue moving forward to whatever it is that you're doing. And yeah, I mean, I was there, and just that example of, like, wow, I'm here again. I'm at the beginning. And I love that feeling of you're at the beginning process of something that you're doing. And I love that feeling. And then, you know, little did I know, all of a sudden I got back here and I have these connections by so many people. And, you know, anthropology, something I have no idea what that is, but I know I needed to talk to them, and here I am having a conversation with them. So that persistence is so key.
Yeah, I mean, I would just, to play off what Jen said, you know, believe you are and believe it can. Like, believe you are a writer, believe you are an activist, believe you are a producer, believe you are a director. Like, believe, because if you don't believe, especially in this industry, like, nobody else is going to do it for you. And then believe it can. Like, believe it can go wherever you want it to go. Believe the project can be seen by however many people you want it to be seen. Believe the media can win any award you want it to win. Like, if you don't believe in it, nobody else is going to either. So, you know, hold for an end. It's a daily affirmation. Like, I take my own advice on the good days and on the bad days. I'm like, what are we doing?
I also just want to acknowledge there's so many great trans creators out there now, too. It's like, it's every film festival I go to, the trans content just keeps getting better every year. And Zachary's been doing this stuff for forever, but it's every year there's more. And I'm sure, like, I know Taylor is a producer here, and Sam is a producer and filmmaker. I'm sure there's other really great trans creators, like, all around you, and who've been doing this for, like, a really long time. Some are more visible than others, but we all, if you create something, particularly, like, at least amongst trans people, if you create something, and it doesn't even have to be great, it just has to be made and get out there, other creators will see you, you'll see each other, you'll start working together, you'll inspire and push each other, and it's so fun to, like, see stuff, and then, you know, eventually, you end up collaborating. I think I've collaborated on something with everyone in here at some point, because you just stick around long enough, and it's just really fun. You get to, like, make cool shit with people you like.
Yeah, and developing, like, continuing those friendships, and you have a community of creative, like-minded people.
I mean, I've been saying this on Twitter for a while. I really believe that. I think we're at, it's so far, there's been, every, 15, 20 years, there's been a Hollywood revolution. But if you read the history of Hollywood, every revolution has been a new group of basically a group of young straight white men who are pissing off the older straight white men. And that's considered a Hollywood revolution. And it's true. I mean, the norms and values do change, and so the new young white men, you know, come in. I think what we're on the verge of is the first time that there's a revolution in Hollywood that is not new young white men. It's everyone but young white men. And that's so exciting to me, because I think that there's an audience that's ready for that. We have, you know, all these stories that have never been told before. And now is our time. Now is our time. And we can all do it together.
And with that, now is our time.
I dropped the mic.
I think we should take this on the road. All over the world, this conversation. I think it will be on YouTube at some point.
I would have worn makeup and clothes had I known this could be tamed.
You look great.
We'll have a nice filter in post production.
We're gonna be hanging out in the back patio. There's a movie at 5, La Visita. It's a Chilean film about a trans woman who goes home for her father's funeral. It's incredible. It's an art house film starring this incredible trans woman shot in the Chilean countryside. Shorts program at 7:30. The Queen and Queens at Heart, two vintage films. I think that's the hottest ticket of the festival, with a conversation with Paula Sabrina, one of our elders, who started running drag contests in 1959. Both of those films feature pre-Stonewall trans and gender non-conforming communities, and they're both very rare and very hard to see.
And thank you, Zackary, for finding that stuff and showing it to the world. No, but you are.
Yeah, thank you.
Y'all don't know that it's Zackary who's been championing like Hollywood Lawn and Fall Sabrina and all these folks that might have been forgotten otherwise. She's the one who's keeping the materials alive, keeping them relevant today, and like making sure that their stories aren't forgotten.
Thank you.